I've got Terry and Gary from the Across the Park podcast in the studio. Good afternoon, guys.
Hi, mate.
Afternoon, Matt.
We're going to start with the Blues because Andre Gomez has given his first press conference as an Everton player today, and he's gone full Robbie Keane. Love at first sight.
Massively, yeah. To be fair, we've kind of suspected that. I think through the way he's engaged with the community since he's been here, and it seems like every PR event Everton were doing, he was there and involved. But it's a bit cliche, isn't it? Kind of rubbing it on as thickly as he has done.
It's going to get to a point in maybe 2 or 3 years' time when clubs realise that this isn't what fans want to hear the players say anymore, yeah. Because they all know that it's just rubbish.
Yeah.
Every player, who joins a new club, they will tell you, oh, I'm joining this club because it's the biggest club that I could have joined and I love the manager and the fan base looks brilliant. Yeah. I'm sure Andre Gomez does have some affection for Everton, but it's just the same every interview now, isn't it?
Yeah, it seems to be. But again, I'm going to say he does seem to have a bit of affection. I think that the biggest thing for him, reading in between the lines and listening to the full interview, is that I think he just appreciated being loved again. You know, he'd been a big player at Valencia. He's obviously made the breakthrough to the Portugal squad at that time. He was rated across Europe. He'd probably gone into Barcelona buzzing, feeling good about himself. And by all accounts, he was kind of parked a little bit, wasn't he? I mean, rightfully so, alongside the likes of Iniesta and Busquets. But I think he, coming to Everton, he was just looking to try and rediscover his love for the game. And even though it's been communicated in the press conference by him that it, you know, he loves the fans, he loves the club, I think he's just loving his footy again, to be honest. And that's something that come through towards the end of the season. He was fit again. He was starting to look like the missing part of the puzzle that, you know, that we've, since Mikel Arteta left, we haven't had a player of that ilk and someone who was so comfortable on the ball and was capable of playing at the highest level. And I think similar to Arteta, when we brought him from Sociedad, he was a player who should have been playing at a higher level, but he kind of lost his way a little bit and lost his confidence, and we were able to take advantage of that. And in this case, we've done the same. I just hope that we can now build the team around him that's going to keep him there, because that's always been the issue, is we get players like him, they push on a little bit, and then those words he was saying about the fans suddenly get forgotten because he's, you know, the big likes of Madrid or Barcelona come shining again.
Well, he had a few clubs interested in him. I think Spurs were linked at one point, West Ham perhaps a little bit more heavily, and he was asked about it today and he basically said, I just talked to my brother, my best friend and my agent. I told him I preferred to stay here. Everton was my first option.
I'd like to believe that. I mean, West Ham, I always thought when the West Ham link came about, it didn't make sense for me for them to go there. Now, Spurs, I could have understood that. And if there was genuine interest from Spurs, then it's a coup for us to have kind of beat them to a player, because they're in a really good position. I would look at their team and think that he could walk into their team, because before they bought Dombele and from Lyon, I think there was a bit of a gap in there. With they've got a few defensive midfielders and a few attacking midfielders, but no real box to box midfielder. So if they were genuinely interested, then I think it's a big boost for us to be beating them in the market. But again, I just think he wants to have a good couple of seasons now where he's playing footy, he's enjoying it, and hopefully he's getting back amongst European competitions, which is something he also spoke about in his press conference.
I think, like what you said there, you know, you want to see Hughes go out now and sort of build a team around him. Where does that leave Sigurdsson? Because I think there has been times in the past, hasn't there, this season, where they don't seem to have meshed together very well. You know, like it seems like there's like a clash of styles or something where they just don't seem to jive very well. And Sigurdsson's, you know, throughout his career, he's always flourished in teams that are built around him. You know, your Swansea's and stuff, and Iceland, you know, the national team. When he went to Spurs and he was like a bit more of a marginal player, and a piece in a bigger jigsaw, I suppose, you didn't get the best out of him. So, you know, are we going to get the best out of Sigurdsson and Gomez at the same time? And which one would you prefer to build the team around out of the two?
I'd like to think it's a good problem to have, first and foremost, for Marco Silva. And it's a challenge that I think he'll have in pre-season. I think the argument against that, and I was certainly a person who brought that up a few times, that I felt that they weren't really playing well together, or that there wasn't the right balance when they were in the same team. I think towards the end of the season, when we got those wins at Goodison, it looked like they kind of found a little bit of a balance there. And particularly when Garner Guy started to find his feet a bit more and starts to find his place in the team. But if you're going to ask me which one I would take right now, I couldn't even answer you because
not
we haven't
necessarily. I don't think we've got both of them.
Yeah, I don't think we've got the goals. If one had to make way because the other one didn't fit, I don't think we've got the goals in the team yet up front to lose Sigurdsson. Mm. But I think long term, I would like to think we'll have three forwards that'll contribute, and therefore you'd think that he would eventually make way in that case for a more balanced midfield.
So you want to build a team around him. Who of the current squad, and then particularly the starting 11 from last season, can help Everton push on to be a top four club?
A consistent season from Pickford, because he was patchy last season, and he obviously had that massive mistake at Anfield which affected him as well as the rest of the team. I think long term he could still be a massive success at the club. I still firmly believe Coleman's got a couple of seasons in him, if not one good season, and then maybe it might be time for him to move on. Zouma isn't our player yet, so it's hard to call it, put him in that 11. Michael Keane, I'm still not sure about, so I'd start with Pickford, Coleman. Digne, naturally, as being the player of the year, was a massive success. I'd love to still keep older Ghana guy. I still think he's got a lot to offer. It's just whether we can fend off the potential interest of clubs. I don't think there's anyone else in that midfield long term. Like Teddy's argument before about Sigurdsson, that still is a question that needs to be asked. I would prefer to obviously keep, you know, Richarlison in there. There's still doubt over Calvert-Lewin's long-term future, although he showed last season that he's got a place. We still need two forwards for me, as in a wide player and a proven centre-forward. Bernard had a very good season next year. I still think he's got a place in the squad, and long-term I'd like to think that he'd be the answer as a wing, but he still hasn't delivered the goods in the way of assists and goals for him to be valued as a mainstay in the team.
Yeah, he looks very good technically, doesn't he? But as you say, his output just hasn't quite been there yet.
Yeah, and it's one of them again, a South American player who's come from the Ukraine via being out of, you know, being on the sidelines for 4 months. You can forgive him that, but I think having seen what I seen last year, I wouldn't put my neck on the line and say, look, he's first 11, someone that we can't quite replace yet. Mm.
It's Radio City Talk, Gary and Terry from the Across the Park podcast are here. Just to go back to Michael Keane there, you mentioned him. Does he need a good centre-half next to him to perform?
Yeah, I think you did see it when Zouma settled into the team. I think that was the best we'd seen Michael Keane probably the last 10 games. And it was, aside from maybe one game, Zouma was playing alongside him. So that's why I think that potentially trying to secure the Zouma signature or someone like that is going to be massive for him, because he had games alongside Yerry Mina where Yerry Mina hasn't settled clearly to the Premier League yet. I'm not really sure what type of defender Yerry Mina is going to be even when he does settle. He's certainly not someone who's going to lead from the back, where Zouma seemed to grow in confidence, and therefore Michael Keane could play off him a little bit more. I think you're right. I don't think I can really hang my hat on Michael Keane until we've got a centre-back alongside him who's going to give him someone who we can be sure about.
Bit of a worry though, isn't it? Someone who got, what, £25 million price tag put on his head and he signed, and he was seen as a marquee signing, I would say, because of the price tag. Under-delivered in his first season. Last season was very good, but a bit of a concern if you need someone alongside him to perform.
It is, yeah. Arguably, and Burnley fans will tell you, he always had someone alongside him there to perform. Tarkowski, Ben Mee. The Burnley fans who I've spoke to would have told you that he wasn't the man that we should have signed. It would have been one of the other two, but, you know, fortune has it that we did sign him. I wouldn't even say he has a very good season last season. I think he was improved. He was closer to the level we would have expected, but again, a lot of Evertonians would tell you that's a big part to do with Zouma, and also to do with the balance back four that we managed to achieve in the end. You know, the run of games that we had with Digne, Coleman, Zouma, Keane and Pickford, any team or any successful team is built around a solid, consistent back five, and we got that for the first time probably 25 games into the season. So if we can, you know, maintain that stability, and that's only going to be achieved really by securing the Zouma signing, I think we might see the Keane that we paid £25 million for a couple of seasons ago.
Signing Zouma, potentially then more important than signing Gomez?
Yes. Yeah, I think it's a fair comment. We've got more bodies in midfield and more bodies that are capable of doing a job at this level. Even though I'm not a massive fan of him, Schneiderlin is still proven at that level if you can get him fit. We haven't got anyone else in that back four aside from the two fullbacks that are proven at this level. If you put Keane in that same category. So I do agree that the Zouma signing was more important. And I think that would have been the one they would have got done first had it not been for this transfer ban and the managerial situation at Chelsea.
It's going to be interesting. We'll talk about Frank Lampard in a bit, but it's going to be interesting to see whether he does want him back or not, because by all accounts, Zouma wants to stay.
Yeah, and I think he wants to stay for similar reasons to why Gomez wants to stay, is he's found a club that have given confidence again and a manager who given confidence. You know, he finished the season in Everton in a bit of a place where it's, you know, there's that feel-good factor's coming back. He knows there's investment coming into the club. He's not quite under the pressure that he was at Chelsea, and he's also not fighting relegation that he was at Stoke. So I think he'll have been another player that finished the season on a high and would have wanted to kind of pick that up again. He's got back in the French squad for the first time in, I think, two or three seasons. So, yeah, it will be interesting. And I will come on to Frank Lampard, but he does look like the type of player that if you just come into a club, you'd be mad not to keep him, really. Because he's the right side of 20, I think he is 25 exactly. So he's got Premier League experience, but he's still young, isn't he? And not going to cost them anything.
And they're under a transfer embargo as well. If I'm an Everton fan, the one thing that I'm slightly concerned about at the moment is that if Zouma comes in, that's £52 million spent on standing still, on having exactly the same squad as last year.
That's right, but I made the point today in work with my colleagues to say, well, the first thing you've got to do is make sure you don't go backwards. And by securing those two signings, you know, we're at least starting at a position where we can move forwards. The argument against that would be, we're not going to stand still because of the fact that we've got Bernard, who, like we said before, who has had a season to settle in. Richarlison, okay, he's played a season in the Premier League, but I still think there's more to come from him. Dominic Calvert-Lewin will only push on again. Luka Dinia, I think, has got another level to go to. Yerry Mina, we haven't seen anything from him yet. So I think there are players in the squad who haven't yet matured to the Everton style of play and also to the Premier League. But you're right, I would like to think there's at least £120 million for Marco Silva to spend if, you know, the rumours have it, and the fact that we're starting to shift the likes of Sandro, who's gone back out on loan. You know, there's players still to come out who I think will free up a little bit of extra money. But, you know, we are now into July, and only seeing the signing of Gomez has got to be a bit of a concern now.
Big Sandro, finally gone.
Big Sandro's money
Sandro's only been loans. You should be subsidising that.
Via the league come out. I can't believe they didn't know his wages before they come in for him, because everyone else in the world seems to know it. But their comment was, we wanted to take him permanently, but then we seen how much he was on and thought twice about it. And there's no clause in this deal, or there's nothing in the deal, like there's no option to buy at the end of it, which is just means we'll be back in the same situation next year.
Kicking the can down the road, isn't
it? Number nine. He's our number nine as well.
he's spent the last 2 years out on loan and hasn't scored a goal.
Yeah, that says it all. I think he scored, well, got one in pre-season, didn't he? I think the start of last pre-season, but not a competitive goal. That sums it up, really. It was the less said about that signing and his wages, the better.
Who was it, the Liverpool lad, who took the terrible corner?
Markovic.
No, it was Aspas.
He's Everton's Aspas.
I think he's Everton's Markovic, to be honest.
The thing is, Aspas has been... He was scoring goals in Spain. He didn't do it at Liverpool, but then when he's gone back, you know, he sort of found form again and he's scoring goals. So arguably, it's hard to say that Aspas is Sandro.
It's Markovic, definitely. There's a story I heard from last season. Markovic, when the Liverpool are in the States, and a friend of mine was working in the kit team, so he was sitting on the bench next to Markovic. And about 70 minutes of the game goes by and Klopp's made like 10 subs and Markovic is just sitting there with his shin pads on looking at him, and he looks across at my mate and says, not coming on here, am I? And he shook his head and went, no, I don't think so. So he took his shin pads off, and that was the last time he appears anywhere.
20 million quid.
Brilliant.
What a signing. And I want to put a hypothetical situation to both of you. We'll start with you. If Klopp had an absolute nightmare season, he'd fallen out with all the Liverpool fans and he'd got sacked, would you have wanted Steven Gerrard put in charge after 1 year of management at Rangers?
No, is the honest answer. No, because I don't think he's quite, you know, Gerrard certainly in that league, although it's a, you know, it's a tough high profile role and he's under the microscope in a city like Glasgow. There's no way that you're capable of coming in and running a club the size of Liverpool, you know, straight away. I know he'll get it and stuff, but not only that, I also think, you know, you're running the risk of just like sort of tainting your legacy. If you come in and you don't do a good job, then the fans, you know, you might end up with the whole sort of not quite as bad, but a sooner situation where you sort of just alienate the fan base, you know, and you, their experience of you as a manager is completely different from their experience of you as a player. So I wouldn't want to see it personally, Gerrard, just flying parachuted in to sort of rescue it if Klopp had had a bad season. Like,
I can't think of any Everton similarities who are currently... David Unsworth, I guess, is the closest.
Probably Duncan Ferguson, or, but again, they're not managing anywhere, are they? I mean, I was shaking my head there because...
Phil Neville.
Oh, God, I can't believe it. Phil Neville is now associated as being like an all-time legend Everton player. He was our captain for a while, and now he's done a great job with the women's, the ladies, to get them to the semi again, which they've been in a few times now. I was shaking, first of all, on Terry's when I was shaking my head looking at you, because I think in the context of the question, if he's all hated Klopp the way that the Chelsea fans hated Sarri, I think the thing you'd want most is just that feeling of someone you like.
Yeah, there is that. But do you know what?
I think about Hodgson. He was made up to get Dalglish after Hodgson.
Yeah, because it's very different, though. You know, the thing with Chelsea fans is why are they so against Sarri? You know what I mean?
He's had a... Why were you so against Hodgson?
Because, mate, he absolutely had nothing going for him. You know what I mean? He didn't even say the right things when you know, against...
Neither did Sarri, though.
He let Torres get dug out by Ferguson and didn't say it. And then when he got questioned on, he said, I know Alex. He's a good friend of mine. It's like, go away, mate. You don't get this club at all. Just get out of here. So I can't see why Chelsea fans have got the same, anywhere near the level of... You can't say they've got anywhere near the level of, like, grudge with Sarri that we had with Hodgson. Completely different levels, and I don't think Sarri actually done that bad a job in tough circumstances, to be honest, with Abramovich, who feels like he's pulled back a little bit at Chelsea, you know, from, like, he doesn't seem as interested as he was originally. The stadium thing's on hold, you know, he's ended up having players who are almost bigger than the manager and telling him no, they're not coming off the pitch when he's trying to sub them and all kinds of stuff like that. You know, dressing room, real dressing room upheaval and things, and transfer bans hanging over him, all kinds. It was a tough gig, I think, and I don't really see why they've got such a dislike of him in his first season. It's like, what is it?
A trophy as well.
They're all fair points to that. I think I just looked at the squad they had, and even though they end up finishing third in the end because of...
I think they were third, yeah.
It was third, and Tottenham may have slipped to fourth, and obviously winning a trophy in the end, it looks like a decent season. But I just think what he did to Kante, and the way... not what he did to him, as if he's like put him on the bench, but... He was their best player, wasn't he? You know, Hazard had a great season, so he probably still got the best out of him. But you look at their first 11, their starting 11, should have been a lot closer to the top two than they were.
I know what you're saying. Like, Kante, you know, it was a strange one to sort of move him and try and make him into a player that, you know, maybe he isn't. But at the same time, they've gone out and bought Jorginho. You know what I mean? Who's a top player.
Yeah, he insisted on him, though, and that's it. And you could see the whole... Everyone could see that Jorginho wasn't fitting in. It's like, come on, just swallow your pride and put Kante in the position that he belongs, and he's proven in the Premier League. And just wait, just be patient with Jorginho.
Yeah,
the stubbornness in the press conference, the way he was ignorant to the Chelsea fans' complaints and just going, well, listen, he's my player.
Chelsea have a problem with managers, though, don't they?
Yeah,
they've
absolutely.
Got a serious problem. The way that they are going through them. You look at what Rafa did there. Sacked after winning trophies. You look at what Roberto Di Matteo did there, sacked after winning the Champions League.
Yeah.
They've got no issue with hiring and firing managers at will. Abramovich is not going to be given the same length of rope by Chelsea fans if he does that to Lampard, and he can't afford to because they've got two transfer windows where they can't sign anyone anyway.
Yeah, I think it's a bit of an astute appointment by them, to be honest, by the club, because I think Lampard will get, you know, patience off the fans. You know, there'll be a period where, you know, they'll excuse any mistakes that he makes or any sort of slip-ups or things like that. They're not going to jump on his back in the same way that they seem to appear to love jumping on the back of anyone else who's there who hasn't got some sort of association with Chelsea previously. And, you know, as you say, with the transfer windows, it almost gives him a bit of a pass, really, in that he's stuck with the squad he's got. He can't improve it, you know. So it's almost like... He won't be questioned because it's like, well, my hands are tied. I can only work with what I've got, and I didn't sign these players. So I don't, you know, I can see it from that side of things why it's a good PR sort of move by the club to take it, you know, to try and get the fans back on side. And maybe that'll be, you know, the thing that helps Lampard sort of settle in quickly, or, you know, sort of bed in a little bit in that he will get that license and that little bit more time that other managers haven't got under Abramovich. But I wouldn't want to see it. I mean, if she was on the other foot and it was a Liverpool situation.
He's saying all the right things already, isn't he? Because he's saying, I want players, whether they're 18 or 32, I want players who want to play for Chelsea. And if you are the supporter who, you know, is behind the club for the reasons of passion and not just chasing trophies, then you do want those types of players out there. And that's been certainly lacking in Chelsea's team for a long time, isn't it? Local lads who are, since Terry and Lampard, really, there's not been any kind of local players who are kind of putting the shirt on and playing with passion, which, when you've got no money and you haven't got a budget, they're the things that give you that extra bit of satisfaction, aren't they?
But I mean, I don't necessarily think local players, and we all want them and all, you know, like it when we see them come through.
Not just local players though.
You look at City, though,
Drogba.
You know, you look at like a City. You know, they haven't got, if they got like really Phil Foden.
No, but they still had company, didn't they? Who played for the badge, and he played like a fan. And again, with Drogba, Lampard, Terry, you know, he has a spine to the team there that was like that. That's what I think a lot of Chelsea fans associate their success with. And when you look at it now, and you've got Higuain, and you've got Jorginho, and you've got David Luiz, it's lost that kind of.
But I mean, the other issue that they've got is that, you know, they keep going through managers, and you're not going to build any sort of identity or players you can maybe get on side with sort of building an affinity with the club.
But when
a manager brings them in, and a new manager comes in and bombs them out, or sort of, you know, wants a change of someone else, you end up with this constant transition and flux with your squad, where, you know, different managers, players, all of a sudden that manager's gone, and maybe they're not feeling the love. So you're not going to build any sort of squad identity or squad of, like, you know, unity, are you, when you keep going through managers at the rate that they are?
What I want to see is, we were often told, especially when Mourinho was there and a couple of others managers as well, that the dressing room at Chelsea was a real problem, in that they forced the manager's hand in terms of selection and in terms of tactics. And Lampard was around that dressing room at that time. Whether or not he was a key instigator in that, I don't know. There are only certain people who would. But if you look at the squad from when he was last at Chelsea in 2014, Aspilicueta is still there. I think, is Gary Cahill gone now, or is he still around?
I think he's still on the
books. I think he might be a free agent, because I think I've seen him on that Sky list of players who are available.
Well, David Luiz is still there. They've still got Willian as well. Unfortunately for Frank Lampard, Thomas Callas has been sold today, so it's not going to be him. But there are still some players from that dressing room that are still there.
That's always an interesting dynamic, isn't it? If you've been a player who shared the dressing room with them, and as you're potentially alluding to, if you've been on the other side of the fence when Lampard's been digging out a manager, which I don't, from what I know of his professional character, he didn't ever seem to be that player, but also he was a massive Chelsea fan in the end as well as a player. So he with him having the club's interests at heart, he may have been someone who's called out the manager when the going's got tough. I just think in the stage in his managerial career, it is very important that he tries to identify those characters as early as possible and gets them as far away from the dressing room as he can. And if you're talking about those three there, Aspilicueta, Willian, I don't think it'd be a bad move to get him out the club anyway, because I think he's probably the most they're going to get for him this summer, because his contract's going to be running down. I think he's got less than 2 years left on his contract. Aspilicueta is the wrong size, I think, of 30 now as well. I think the rest of the squad, if you look at a lot of the players that are out on loan, you know, like, is Mason Mount still a Chelsea player as well, isn't he? You know, they've got some talented kids out there on loan. If Zouma, I think, as much as it hurts me to say, I think he'd be mad not to take him back, because of the fact that he's got experience and he's still fairly young. I just think it is definitely important for him that he establishes that the right type of environment in the dressing room that's going to allow him that time, but also make the players realise that he's building their reputations at the same time.
And we need to get on to the Reds.
Not the
There's nothing to talk about. It's very quiet, isn't it?
Yeah, it is a quiet period. You know, obviously, I didn't think we'd be really busy in the transfer window anyway, but at the moment, it just seems to be nothing really out there to talk about.
I'm quite enjoying just not being in the media for a bit. Sick of every time I turn the TV, some flag on the telly or watching that game again or something. So it's a change that you're on.
You've got the DVD. Yeah. You've got it saved on your planner. We all know it.
Which one's that?
The Champions League final.
Come on, Gary.
There are so many players still away on international duty, though, aren't there? We know Kate has had this thigh problem, and there's been a scan on that which has revealed it's not as bad as it could have been. But he's away, Salah's away, Mane's away, Firmino's away, Alisson's away.
Yeah.
Not going to be back for a while.
And obviously, pre-season starts, you know, next week. And You know, I don't think we'll have probably, you know, all of the players back until we go to the States. I think we've got Tranmere in the first preseason game, and then we play Bradford, and then we go to the States then on a preseason tour. And I don't think it's really until we go to America that we'll see most of the big players.
All those players not really getting that rest, well, particularly like Salah, Alisson, is that a worry?
Potentially, because obviously
they had
long seasons anyway, and you know, last summer a lot of them didn't get much time off last summer as well. So it potentially is a bit of a worry. I think there will be, the club will try somehow to find them the time to have at least probably, I imagine, 10-14 days off. I think Klopp's on that last season. He said do not return to the training ground. He basically forced them to go and take breaks when some of them wanted to come back a bit early, and he was like no. And I think they'll have to do that again. I think it is what it is, though, isn't it? I mean, it's just the nature of the beast, isn't it? Yeah. If you're involved in cup competitions and things at the end of the season,
could have been a lot worse for you, though. You think of the African nations being in the summer. Imagine it was still in January, like it was.
I know, yeah.
You'd have had no Mane,
no Salah,
and no Keita.
We had no Keita.
Yeah, he was injured.
It's true. Yeah.
Yeah. The World Cup final last year was on the 15th of July. The good news for you this year is the Copa America finishes on the 7th.
Final against Peru. Yeah.
So Brazil have got the final against Peru. So those guys will finish on the 7th. The African Cup of Nations final isn't until the 19th of July. So that's exceptionally late.
Yeah,
that's
really late.
3 weeks before the season starts.
And Egypt will almost definitely be competing in it. Well, you know, if it goes to form.
Yeah, it isn't an ideal situation, but as I say, there's not really a lot we can do about it, is there? I suppose the only thing you can say is you'd hope that it, in a way, they stay sort of match sharp, and they just and then they just get like a really sort of intensive 2 week break, and then they come back, and you know, the rat in the swing of things. Hopefully, that's enough. I mean, I know, you know, last season Klopp was very cautious with how he managed the players and rotated them and things, less so with the likes of Salah and Firmino, but certainly with
Alisson.
Goalkeepers, it's one of them.
He does a lot of running.
I know
Alisson,
he does a lot of...
He constantly does, off his line, shouldn't even be off there half the time, but yeah.
He is, but, you know, I can't really see many goalkeepers complaining that the tired.
The legs are tired.
Your legs are gone, got dead legs, so...
Get him a deck chair.
But yeah, so, you know, we've just got to sort of hope that we get through these competitions without any injuries. I know Kate has been sent back to Melwood, and as you say, the scan's been done. It seems like it'll be okay, which is good news, because, you know, he really needs a good pre-season with Liverpool, I think, if he's going to cement any sort of position in that team for next year.
Do you expect the first month, maybe even 6 weeks of the season, then to see very little of Salah?
Yeah, I don't think we will see much of him, to be honest. It'll probably be, you know, maybe the pre-season games at the back end of the summer. I think we finish off with games against Napoli and Lyon, I think it is. So you might see them in them games. You might see him in them games, but I don't think we'll probably see him before then. Although he will, I'm imagining, have to go on the club tour of the States, because obviously he's the most high-profile player, and you know, them fans over there, and he'll have engagements to do for on the club's behalf. So I don't know whether he'll feature lightly in any of the games, but you know, I think he probably will have a part to play.
It's interesting because last year rotated a little bit, but arguably going to have to do it even more with that strike force this year, because last year, Senegal and Egypt were knocked out so early anyway.
Yeah. And then obviously Salah was injured anyway, wasn't he? Really, he wasn't fully fit when he went to the World Cup. But it is a concern that we've mentioned throughout last season. You know, the forward line. If any of them players get injured, we do have options. You know, we can do things, but it doesn't feel like we've got any options really that are of the caliber of either of them front three. You start having to really shift the shape and things, and drop Shaqiri in. And that's why I think, you know, there's a lot of Liverpool fans are looking for us to maybe go out and buy someone. Sturridge is gone. He wasn't capable of filling that void. And I don't think Origi is quite at the level that we need him to be, to come in and replace a Firmino, a Mane or a Salah. So I think we probably will have some eyes out there looking to sign some players. And there's still talk of Timo Werner, isn't there? I know we're linked with him, a Bayern Munich are linked with him, but he's told his club that he doesn't want to stay there. So whether anything will happen towards the back end of the window, and you know, maybe we do get an option in, it gives us that capability to do some rotation up at the front line.
Guys, we've run out of time. Thank you for your time this afternoon.
Cheers, Matt.